Have you ever walked into a classroom and thought, why is everybody else so smart? Well, that's because reading is only part of the battle. As a graduate student, when you go to class, you are expected to not just have done the readings, but to be able to contribute to academic discussion. So if you're somebody who's scared about sounding dumb in your class, or if you're somebody who just doesn't understand how everybody around them seems to be so much smarter than them, don't panic. Because today we are discussing strategies on how you can sound just as smart as everyone else. Super important disclaimer though, if you got into grad school and you are going to class and you are doing the readings, I guarantee you are just as smart as everybody else. So this isn't to reaffirm that you're not smart because you're not doing these things, but rather it's to give you the skills to participate in academic discussion. So independent of your ability to do this or to have been doing this before, or your decision to use these strategies in the future, I guarantee you are in fact smart, and don't let anybody make you feel any different. So one of the most basic things that you can implement today to make yourself sound smarter in your discussion or in your seminar as a graduate student is to do background research on the text you are reading. And the reason that you want to do that is because the context in which the readings that you are reading are coming up really influences how they are written, why they are written, and what they're trying to do with their writing. So by doing background research on the text that you are using in class, you are already building on so much more information that you can bring into class and present as a wealth of knowledge. So if you're not really sure on how to start this process of doing background research, I think these questions are really good basic first steps. You want to know who this person is. So that would include, where are they from? What is their positionality? And by positionality, I mean, what is their race or ethnicity? What is their gender? Are they, you know, wealthy or their socioeconomic class? But knowing this type of context helps you get an understanding of kind of the perspective that the author is coming from. You may also want to know, where are they from? Or where did they go to school? So again, you're getting an idea of how they were trained and what they care most about as scholars or academics. Then you want to think about, who do they mention within their introduction or throughout their reading? And this is really regarding other scholars, other theorists that they are really talking about. And you want to do a little background information or background check on them. So you, again, you're getting a larger context of why this was written, who it was written by, and what do they care most about. And this background research can really help bring a lot more to the conversation in your seminar, because you're not just focused on the words that are on the paper, but now you have this larger context and you're seeing it not only as what it's written as, but also as a historical document that can help guide us or help the class understand a larger social implications of a text or of a reading that you're doing together. Another thing is, as young scholars or as junior scholars, we may have the inclination to do readings to understand what the author is saying. And that is a very essential aspect. But also, as PhD students, we are going through the process of developing critical analysis and critical thinking skills. And so what this means is, when you are reading your text, you want to read with a very specific goal. And really, that goal should be understanding the significance of the reading. Now, significance can apply to a variety of different things. So it's really important to know, again, what is the most important aspects for the context you are reading. So what's great is, in the context of a class, you already know what are the major themes of that week, or what are the major questions of the class. And so that's a way that you can approach the readings with a goal. So what's amazing about doing readings within a classroom structure is that the goal is kind of already brought out to you. And so if you are in a class that has a very rigorous or structured syllabus, you may want to do the reading and figure out, how does it connect, or how can you put it in relation to the major theme of that week, or the major theme or questions of the class. If your class is a little more kind of hard to figure out or vague or general, you could also try to connect it to the previous readings that you've done and see how they are in conversation with each other, how they build on each other, how they contrast with each other, and really develop a connection or a goal in that way. Being critical of your readings doesn't necessarily mean that you're looking to find a problem or that there's got to be something wrong with it, but really you're trying to understand why it matters and to whom it matters. And so by either connecting it to the major themes or questions of the class, or by connecting it to previous readings, you are already demonstrating its significance to the very least your professor and your classmate. Now, if you're doing a one-off shoot kind of workshop or group reading thing where there's not a course topic or major course questions, or there aren't previous readings that you can kind of riff off of, do not panic, because there's definitely guiding questions to help you get to that point. So questions that can help guide you through reading with a goal when there isn't a more structured focus is, who is the audience? Who did the author intend for this text to be addressed to? And why do you think that matters? You also probably want to ask, who is excluded and included into this text? And this can include researchers, but it can also include, you know, communities, populations, demographics. And so really thinking about the implications on who is represented, who is misrepresented, and who is not represented at all within the text can also help develop a goal or critical analysis on what the reading is doing. Then you want to ask, who does this text harm? And who does this text support or benefit? And so this type of question can feel a little weird at first, especially if you're not dealing with a text that is directly related to social justice or kind of healthcare or really explicit implications within the text itself. But even something that appears neutral has a general focus or a guide that may not even be cynical, but still benefits a community in a certain way. And so because of that, then the next question you want to ask is, what are the motives of the author? Are they trying to fix something? Are they trying to correct something? Are they trying to, you know, create a new idea or really go back to the old ways and stop progression in a different way? By using these types of questions, you are already, again, situating the text into a larger context. And because of that, you're able to imagine or understand how this text, once again, is significant. And this could be not just to you as a researcher or to your class at large, but to society, to the field, to this very specific topic. And so having these critical analysis questions that are really thinking about, what are the dominant narratives? Who are the people that are being misrepresented or not represented? And who benefits or what are the motives? Helps guide the conversation in a way that, again, is demonstrating you have critical analysis and that you are really thoughtful in your approach to reading, and bringing that into the classroom will no doubt make you appear smart. Also, even though we may want to have all the answers so we can appear smart, the reality is, to sound smart, you don't really need to know all the answers. And so an amazing way to present yourself academically within your course seminar is by presenting thoughtful leading questions. And by doing background research and reading with critical analysis as your focus, or reading with a goal, you are already preparing yourself to develop thoughtful questions, because you are, again, focusing on the context. So before you get to class, after you've done your background research and after you've read with the focus on your goal or on these critical questions, you should ask yourself, now that you have all this information, what else do you think is important? What else do you wish you knew more about? Or what do you think the implications are? And these questions are great questions that you can present in class. So if you find out that this author is from Europe and lived in France for 10 years, but was an immigrant from Angola, and so has this long history of revolutionary background, it would be amazing to come to class or your discussion and ask, I wonder what impact the revolution in Angola had on his thoughts on this topic, or his thoughts on this thing, or their thought on this other thing. So by bringing in that information, not just to present it, but to develop a leading question, is a great way to demonstrate to your classmates, but also to your professor, that you're thinking beyond the constraints of this class and thinking about real world realities and implications of your readings and possibilities beyond just what you're reading. Another way that you can ask leading questions, and it's actually another way to seem smart, is by grounding what you're reading into your research. There's probably nobody else in the room that knows as much about your research topic than you. So it's so important when you have the opportunity in your PhD program to bring it back or to ground it back into what you know best. And so by doing this, some of your leading questions may be directly related to your topic, but it also can just be a way of you presenting new ideas from your unique perspective, because you have this unique context or this unique background as who you are. And so in this way, you are demonstrating or applying what you're reading to you, your research, and the context of the class, and presenting a lot more that people can discuss, because they may not have thought of it in that way, or they may not have read that author that you know really well because it's relevant to you. And so by bringing in your perspectives and bringing in your research, you're also adding value to what is going on in the classroom setting. And this next piece of advice on how to sound smart within your classroom lecture or your classroom discussion is going to feel a little weird at first, but just stick with me. When you are in a classroom and you're doing readings or holding a discussion, it's important that you have an opinion and you stick with it. Now, this isn't to say that you should be hard-headed or immobile or not open-minded to other possibilities, but it is saying that you should have conviction, or you should be confident in what you're saying. If you go into a classroom conversation and you don't have confidence behind what you're saying, or you seem to second guess yourself, or you're presenting everything as a question versus as statements, people aren't gonna really understand where you're coming from. And either subconsciously or consciously, they're going to attack your ideas or challenge what you're saying, because they're just not confident in what you're saying either. Now, of course, this disproportionately affects people who are introverted or live with anxieties or don't handle talking in front of people well. And so definitely this is a skill to develop. And it again is not innately you're smart or not smart, but rather how to present as academically smart. And so when you are in these classroom settings and you're going to make a statement, say it definitively. And then open up space for critique or for people to ask questions, but don't enter it doubting yourself or saying things like, but I don't know, or I could be wrong though. But instead, say what you have to say, say it with your chest, and trust that everything will be okay. And if you turn out wrong, if you turned out challenged, it's going to be okay, because that's part of the academic discourse. And I mean, if we're being honest, if you say something and eventually in the classroom, it's proven wrong, and you take that well, then that also demonstrates that you're smart or academically prepared to engage in academic dialogue. So it can be really intimidating to say your own opinion and stick by it, but trust me, you've come off way more official, way more academically prepared in your classroom when you say a statement that is substantiated or reinforced by the readings or the text, and don't doubt yourself. And by doing that, again, you are reinforcing that you belong in this space. And it's not just being reinforced to those around you, like your professor or your students, but it's also reinforcing it to yourself that you belong in this space and your ideas are worthy, because they definitely are worthy and you definitely belong in those spaces. It's also super important to remember that reading and writing in grad school is a skill. And eventually, even though it may start off difficult, it can and will get easier. So as long as you're continuing to work at it, you're putting yourself out there and you're practicing this skill, you will eventually reach a point where you are engaging in academic discourse with confidence, sounding smart, and being a part of the community that you want to be a part of. Now, if you need a little bit more guidance in that, I have an entire playlist that discusses it and a couple of videos on strategies on how to read if you are a slow and distracted reader, but it can help anybody. If you found at least two things useful, hit a thumbs up so YouTube knows to share this video with others who might need it. And as always, if you have questions or concerns, leave them in the comments below. Your support helps a small YouTuber like me continue to grow. So thank you so much for watching, and I will see you next week.